Good evening and welcome to The Journey Home. Marcus Grodi, your host for this program, this wonderful privilege that I have every week to come into your homes and introduce you to someone who's drawn by the Holy Spirit and his love for Jesus Christ finds their way home. And our guest tonight is Dr. Wesley Vincent, former fundamentalist slash evangelical. We'll get into why that slash is there to understand the difference. But Wesley, it's good to have you.
Thank you very much.
I was thinking as we never plan our attire, but I'm wondering which clans we've set against each other tonight.
And I have no clue.
I think this is the Shaw tartan, which was part of my wife's background, and I don't know which one that is, but somewhere somebody sees us and they're how can they be at the same table together?
Well, it's wonderful to be here, and it certainly is a prize to me to be here in two ways. One is that I never ever would have dreamed that I would have become Catholic in my life, and the second is that I think you have so many people with tremendous merit to be here. And it feels like I'm sitting in the seat of some pretty impressive people, Scott Hahn and Steve Ray, and it's quite intimidating to sit here and talk to you.
Well, first of all, it's a great privilege to have you here.
And Thank you. I
know all those men you've mentioned, and they would say, our honor is having, by the grace of God, to come to know Jesus Christ in his church. You know, that's our great honor. Yeah, that's all we've asked you to come here and share, and glad to have you here, Wes. It really is good to have your clinical psychologist, right?
Yes,
psychiatrist.
I am. No, I'm a psychologist.
Okay, clinical psychologist. And the reason it always fascinates me, Dr. Grischel, Father Grischel was one, Lord rest his soul, but you bring this other side to understanding conversion and recognizing that we're all such unique individuals and what God uses in our character to awaken us. And there are different barriers other than just the apologetic arguments. There's our personalities and where we've come from and all of that shape us. But we might get to that later, but let me get out of the way and invite you to go back and start us out on your journey.
Well, I was born in Michigan, lived there until I was about four. And at that time, my parents attended a Nazarene church. So I grew up with that influence, an Arminian theology, which involves the awareness that we need to stay faithful in our practices, and that if we do commit a sin, we need to confess that sin. And I think of interest is the fact that in our churches, it was often those confessions occurred publicly. So there would be a altar call, and we would then openly confess the sin we had committed and have the church pray for us and the pastor pray for us. We were used to the idea of kneeling to pray. I was unaware until fairly recently that the Nazarene Church actually was an attempt to move in a more holiness direction from what had happened in the Methodist Church. I was named after John Wesley for my first name. And the concept being that we needed to be living faithfully at all times. At four, we moved from Michigan to Massachusetts, and we began attending a Baptist church, which happened to be Calvinistic. And that begins the whole process for me that from fairly early on, not as young as four, but certainly by the time I was eight or nine, I was becoming aware that there were these differences in the way people viewed salvation. And at times sat through some discussions that my parents had with people who were Calvinistic, who in effect believed that if you one time, first of all, that you have no choice in the matter, you just become, God has either chosen you to be part of the body of Christ or has condemned you. And you have no control of what the outcome is. But that then gradually moved in the direction of what I would call the evangelical perspective, which is sort of a combination of a Calvinistic concept, but along with a need to accept Christ as your personal Lord and Savior. Yeah. And certainly the approach via the five spiritual laws that were given back in probably the 70s is when they became very popular through, I think, the Billy Graham Association and others.
Bill Bright.
And Bill Bright,
I remember having been in that camp that there was kind of a symbol that when you're on this side of heaven, it kind of says all come. But then when you get on the other side, if you get on the other side, it says you were chosen. So right. It's this mixture of the call, but yet still there's the assumption is that if you respond, that was because it wasn't your choice. It was God's choice in the first place.
Right. And
I was going to wonder, that's an interesting leap for your parents to go from the Nazarene into this Baptist church. So they themselves, were they struggling with this?
I don't think they were struggling with it at all. I think that they held firmly to the Nazarene concept. But my mother was a choir director, and there was also the concern that when they moved from the Midwest and Bible Belt kind of environment to New England, it was quite different there to find a church that was not a mainstream church. And by mainstream, I mean more of a social club where there was a strong belief in scripture, a pastor who was devout in his own personal life as well as in his ability to portray the message in sermons and in Sunday school lessons, that they looked for a church that had that. And that's what we went to, and it happened to be a Baptist church. Transition, however, continued because when I was about 12, because of some church changes, we ended up going back to a Nazarene church. So from 12 on, this became a real strong issue that I continued to live with throughout my, right up until just a few years ago, which I would describe as this sense that there are contradictory teachings among the Protestant churches. When I first would have been asked, or when I first thought about the idea of how many different Protestant denominations there were, I would have probably thought there were a handful, and accepted the idea that we all pretty much taught the same thing, held to the same concepts. But I think that with the confusion that comes from not having a solid leadership in the church, that each pastor teaches their own take on theology. And so depending on the church you're in, you get different teachings. And some of those teachings are about very serious things. And I think that the first one I ran into was this issue of salvation. Yeah. Are you saved once and for all and safe and secure for eternity? Or do you need to confess additional sins? Or is confessing additional sins only an imaginary thing that's sort of good for us to do, but has no purpose or value otherwise? And that sort of stayed with me.
And I was going to say that even the idea of your early Nazarene church, of the necessity to confess, but to confess in front of the entire congregation, isn't norm amongst the holiness churches that believe you still need you're not guaranteed of salvation. So there's an example of the local pastors or a local group of people having a certain understanding of what confession's all about.
And it's intriguing because I'm aware of, at the time I was 12, 13, 14, of people who left the Nazarene church because they felt as though they were always losing their salvation. Yeah. And they gave up on the process. And I think that may have been because in the churches we went to, there was this tendency to confess openly. Certainly as a young teen, that I had the impression on occasion that I wished that the confessions were a little bit more seedy than they often turned out to be. And at times was dismayed at the types of confessions that occurred, that there would be someone who was sobbing their heart out, and their confession would be that they had watched the baseball game the prior Sunday after church. And it seemed unnecessary in the one sense. I think that what we ran into was there was a tendency to identify all sorts of things as required for the faith, but not truly required. They had nothing to do with whether you were saved, but you better follow a whole list of things. And I grew up in the Nazarene church where there was this, there was no dancing, there was no drinking, there was no smoking, there was no going to beach parties with a co-ed beach party. Women were expected not to wear makeup or jewelry. It was certainly a very austere type of church, But I went at a time when there was a gradual change. And I think if you went to most Nazarene churches today, you would not recognize them, which I also think is part of my journey, is that there was a gradual loss of recognition of what church was. And I think church gradually changed from being a place where you went to worship, and it became a place where you went to fellowship. Mm-hmm. In fact, that was driven home to me a number of years ago when we were looking for a church because of our son being in a youth group, and we were meeting with the pastor, and the pastor asked us why we were interested in coming to that church. And I said I was looking for a place that we could worship. And he said, "You mean fellowship?" And I said, "No, worship." And he said, "You mean fellowship, don't you? Aren't you looking for friends?" And I said, "No," and this may have sounded arrogant. I said, "I have enough friends. I'm looking for a place to worship." And I think he was completely bewildered. But what I guess I didn't realize is I was really barking up the wrong tree, in a sense, that is what I think modern evangelicalism has turned into, is it's a place to get together with other believers where you can feel connected. But I'm not sure the worship is there. And that's part of the transition that I went through. I gradually, and I can tell you that I remember a Sunday when I was 12, I think it was close to my birthday, and I suddenly realized I've heard all of these sermons before. And it's in a church where everyone is a believer. And at the end of most of these sermons, we would have an altar call. In the Baptist church, which I didn't even realize at the time we were there between when I was about 4 and 12, that it almost made no sense for there to be an altar call, because either we're going to be led by God to be saved or we're not. But we had one mentally feeble woman who, whenever she was there, would always go forward and accept Christ again. And that's sad in many ways, but I remember it standing out for me. But as I transitioned through the churches and became more and more aware of this preaching to the choir, but also the more subtle differences in what was being taught in the different churches, that things were necessary in one church, ways of living your life were necessary, and they were allowed in another church. That there was this movement towards church being a place that you felt connected. And worship started to decline. The modern songs were brought into the church, or into the congregations that I attended. And some of them focused more on I and me and us and we, and very little about God.
Yeah, the horizontal.
Yes.
And not the vertical.
Yes. And that was a bit of a turnoff for me. And in college, after I was married, my wife and I started to look a little bit further afield. And we went towards the Presbyterian Church and found, because I was going to college in Wheaton, Illinois, at Wheaton College, we had some really good churches around us.
Right. Very good.
But we went to a Presbyterian church there for a while, and there was a more vertical relationship, more focus on our relationship to God rather than those feel-good hymns.
I'm going to break this, just let the audience, especially on the radio, know Dr. Wesley Vincent is our guest. And you know, it's interesting you said that the movement away from worship to fellowship indeed happened. And it's like you mentioned Wheaton, because you'll find evangelicals reacting against that to try and reclaim that worship, you know, that they're trying to. And sometimes it's another breakaway and another breakaway, trying to get back that which they had. And it's often through the selection of hymns, whether their focus is on the horizontal or whether there's a vertical element in there. And it's interesting, I remember that from my own journey. You're reminiscing of what we've heard, and it's again what you're keying in. This is a movement that's really struck Protestantism in America.
And it's interesting that Christianity Today just did a survey and discovered that I think it was 50% of people sitting in the pews hold to faulty theology. Yeah. But I'm not even sure from a Protestant perspective that we can call it faulty anymore.
I was just wondering.
Because depending on the building you're sitting in, it's either accepted as the truth.
Right.
And I think that it's, and these many of these things I've become aware of more recently, but that there are churches that reject the Trinity. And that's beyond comprehension to me. I don't know how someone can make that step. I came to the conclusion at some point that what we see with churches is, or different groups, is a tendency to be not Catholic. And I almost have the suspicion that when some groups that see themselves as strong Bible-believing, and that's how I would have described myself, yeah. is a Bible believer, that when people saw themselves as Bible believers, the minute they find out the Catholic Church does X, they stop doing X. The last church we attended before we made the transition to the Catholic Church, the pastor, unbeknownst to me, I didn't know that he held this view, he gave a sermon on why he never had the congregation say the Lord's Prayer. And he pointed to the verse just before the Lord's Prayer and said that it would be vain repetition to say the Lord's Prayer. And I was completely dumbfounded. I couldn't conceive of how someone could arrive at yeah. that position. And that sort of confirmed for me, because at that point I already was delving deeply into Catholic theology, that it confirmed that idea of that there's a move to be not Catholic. Mm. And I think that it really gets some more conservative Protestant pastors into a great deal of trouble once they realize that something they're doing happens to be very consistent with the teachings of the Catholic Church.
We've got neighbors where we live that express that exact view. They would never pray the Lord's Prayer because they felt that that was fulfilling this other even though Jesus told us in another verse to pray this way. Right. So they make a choice, and what you're saying is this was not Catholic, their move to what they're going to. As you're moving towards the Catholic Church, we need to delve back. What was your feeling about the Catholic Church growing up and your family and the different churches that you attended?
I was about to jump back myself.
Oh, okay,
on this.
Sorry. Okay.
But good reminder, you should do that throughout the talk okay. or I'll just run off in many different directions. But I think that the first thing was the awareness as a child that Catholics were pagan. And as I got older, it was explained to me basically from Haley's Bible Handbook, which I'm sure you're familiar yep. with, yep. and many people are, that there is this trail of tears or trail of blood throughout history, which are all the martyrs that were martyred by the Catholic Church, and that this is the true church, and that the Catholic Church in approximately 325, when Constantine made it legal to be a Catholic or to be a Christian, and there was only one Christian group at that point, the Catholic Church, that they adopted all the pagan practices to become accepted by the empire. And that was an outlook I had. I held to the Bible right on through my young adulthood, right on up until just a few years ago. I held to the idea that the Bible is the only source of authority. It never once crossed my mind where the Bible came from. Now, what's interesting is that I went to Wheaton College. I got a degree in sociology. I got a degree in biblical studies. And
What you're saying to the audience is you went to probably the best evangelical college in America, or one of the best in America.
Certainly, yeah. and it is recognized yeah. even by the secular community as being right. one of the best schools. It's one of the better schools in the country, let alone being a strong evangelical school. And to go through that and never have a real clear answer as to why and how we got the Bible. Now, bless their hearts. I think that that people who are deeply entrenched in the Protestant world, in the evangelical world, like me, could never even imagine that there could be any other answer than that this just sort of came into being, and it became the manual by which to live our faith. And why ask where it came from, in a sense? But it never was clearly spelled out. I hope that that's not the case today. I hope that there's been an improvement in looking at how and why we came to the Bible. my understanding of the early church fathers going through Wheaton was really in snippets. We read a little bit of this, a little bit of that, enough to support some reason why we practice what we practice today.
Right.
But there was never an exhaustive reading of the early church fathers. And from college on, I always had this sense of I want to read the early church fathers, but never ever got around to it. But back to my childhood, I was brought up to believe that that Catholics were sadly not Christians. And my mother on one occasion mentioned to me that these neighbors across the street from us that went to Mass every day, she mentioned that it was very, very sad to think that these poor people were not going to heaven because they hadn't accepted Christ as their personal Lord and Savior. And these were devout believers and kind people, but they would not respond to my mother's witnessing to them. They would just smile and say thank you, and I'm sure they were quite perplexed as to how they were supposed to respond. I think that today there's more of an awareness in the Catholic Church that you can actually say, I have accepted Christ as my personal Lord and Savior. That was just terminology that they didn't understand, and yet as I look back now, they obviously were profoundly devout believers. But in my mother's understanding, they weren't going to heaven. I have a sense that Mary played a huge role in my coming to the church. And I say that because growing up in a devout Christian family, it sadly was not a happy family. It was a terribly sad family. I don't think there's a picture of me before I met my girlfriend, who became my wife of almost 40 years now, of me smiling. It was a very sad family, and for many different reasons. But I would go by Catholic churches and see the statue of Mary and think how sad it was that we couldn't have that, because Mary seemed so marvelously peaceful. Christmas cards for me that were of the Holy Family, particularly Mary and the Christ Child, would allow me to daydream about a happy family. So that was a huge issue for me. Wow. as I grew up, but I didn't know that. I didn't know that
she wasn't talked about much in either Nazarene or the Baptist Church.
No, not at all. I think another thing that led me into the Catholic Church early on was I had a driving desire to receive communion. And for Catholic listeners or viewers, communion is the same as receiving the Eucharist. And I wanted to receive that, but we weren't allowed to. You had to be at least 12 to become a member of the church to be baptized. And you were
in
not
in the Baptist church.
In the Baptist church, but in the Nazarene churches, it was the same.
Okay.
You had to be older, and old enough to have reached the age of reason, which they tended to think of as about 12 years of age. And they might have baptized someone a little bit younger, a little bit older, but you couldn't receive communion until you were baptized. Now it's interesting that all Protestant churches see communion as a symbolic thing. It is not a real thing. You are not receiving the body, blood, soul, and divinity of Christ. You are just sort of doing a nice little ritual for the guy that took the bullet for us, in a sense. And it is purely a ritual. But I had this strong desire to receive. And when I was about 8 or 9, I realized I'd asked to go to the bathroom right after communion service had been served, and discovered that they had deposited all the crackers, all the matzo crackers that were broken up into little pieces, and all the little individual glasses of Welch's grape juice in the kitchen. And from that point on, I always had to use the bathroom right after communion. And I would go down and sometimes serve myself more than I was supposed to. I was sure I was going to go right to hell. And if my mother ever found out about it, I'd have been punished severely, I'm sure. But it really meant something to me. Now, what's interesting is that desire lasted until I became a member of the church And then because of pastoral changes, movement from one church to another, we almost never had communion again. And I remember having communion from the time I was about 13 until college, maybe three or four times. So for a number of years, just because of a fluke as to what was happening in the congregations we attended, we didn't have communion served. When I went to Wheaton, I attended a huge church there, and I don't know that they even had communion because I never once ever heard of a communion service at this church. And but it was where many of the other students went. We went because the singing was great. The pastor had fantastic sermons, and we enjoyed that. So we went there, but we never had communion. But in my heart, there was always a longing for that. And I see both of those as having played a role in pulling us from what I'd say was the fundamentalist evangelical perspective towards what I'll call the more formal practice of worship. We moved towards a Presbyterian church for a period of time. We then gradually, because of after we finished college, we moved back to a New England town, and we visited all the churches in the town. And sadly, one Baptist church we visited, the pastor couldn't have had more than a high school education, and it was embarrassing with a degree in biblical studies to hear his sermons. I would have just sat there shaking my head. And so we couldn't feel comfortable going there. We went to a Methodist church, we went to a Congregational church, and we went to all the churches in this small community. And they ranged from extremely fundamentalistic to where scripture would be replaced by a nice poem. And we then went, drove a bit of a distance to another town and went to the next closest church, which was another Baptist church. And you just have to picture this, a young couple walking into a small Baptist church. I do sing fairly well, and I can go to churches and have people right after the service have asked me if I would come back and sing for the choir, join the choir. Not that I'm great, but I'm good enough. Not a single person even recognized us in the church. They totally ignored us. I sang the hymns. The pastor never recognized us. My wife and I go into this church and we leave, and not a single person looked in our direction, as far as we know. So we didn't feel comfortable going back to that church. And there was one church left in that town, and that was an Episcopal church. And it was within a block of our apartment, and we walked there the next Sunday, and it was an evangelical Episcopal church, and we loved it. And communion was served at every service. And my sense was, I had found my home. It was wonderful. And for the next couple of years, we had a wonderful evangelical and with Eucharistic or liturgical experience, which I loved.
You know, it's really sad to hear what you were describing, and that is not only for some evangelical Protestants had the Eucharistic words of our Lord become merely symbolic, but they weren't even following his instructions to do this in remembrance of me, because they weren't doing it anymore. And I know that when I was a pastor, we did it once a month. But again, it was just a ritual that kind of came up on that Sunday and often caused a problem for us. How are we going to fit everything in this Sunday if we got communion thrown in? And so we never really appreciated it that much. We're going to take a break now, and I want to just tell the audience that Dr. Vincent's conversion story in more detail is available on the Coming Home Network website. We featured it in the newsletter in the past. And just to let you know that, chnetwork.org is our website in case you want to catch other conversion stories that have been printed in the newsletter. Let's take a break now. Come back just a bit. Welcome back to The Journey Home. I'm Marcus Grodi, your host. Our guest tonight is Dr. Wesley Vincent. And I've paused you in the middle of your journey where you've become a happy Episcopalian, where you have, as you said, an evangelical flavor, but also the flavor of the Eucharist there. Mm-hmm. But I've been wondering, you've mentioned along the way that your wife was on this same journey. Had she any Catholic background to her?
My wife was Catholic, and we met at a Bible club that was in the community where we were, and it drew kids from several towns around. Every Thursday we would get together with somewhere between 50 and almost 100 kids in the living room of a man who I look to as sort of my second father, and someone who displayed the love of Christ in ways I cannot even conceive of. Yeah. This was a man that anyone who knew him would be privileged to know him. In having read Charles Dickens, I would say that if you take any of the good characters in Charles Dickens, that this is what my friend Alan C. Emery Jr. was like. This was a man who was devoutly Christian, and was devoted to reaching out to people, and especially to young people. And he took us into his home. I had the privilege of living at his home on occasions when there were difficulties in my own home. And the experience of a loving Christian home that I knew the Christian part, some of the loving part, because I grew up in a family where they not only believed in, but practiced spare the rod, spoil the child. And so I clearly knew what it was like to experience a great deal of pain and distress as a child. But the home at the Emery's helped me to come to know others as representing Christ to us. And from the time I was a teenager on, I had this underlying sense of Mr. and Mrs. Emery were Christ to me. Mm. The concept of if someone, anyone we run into in our everyday life, they may be meeting Christ through us, became very real for me because of how they lived their lives. Mm. And they were the only people I knew well as Protestant Christians who actually believed and accepted that Catholics were Christians. And I remember sitting at dinner with them once, and we had met a family, a Catholic family that Mr. Emery worked with, and the Catholic family had left, and I then asked Mr. Emery, I said, well, you were talking like they were Christians. And he said, well, they are Christians. They're unbelievably devout Christians. That was back in the 70s in New England. He didn't have the most positive view of the priests in the area, but he knew a number of sisters, and his business involved working with a lot of Catholic hospitals, and said that he had never met more devout people than the sisters that he rubbed shoulders with on a regular basis. But my wife was born into a Protestant or a Catholic family, but she transitioned right into Protestantism with me once we met, and we were going to this Bible club and went off to college, went off to, you know, premier Protestant or evangelical college, and we just continued to practice Protestantism from that point on. That brings us back to where we left off, and we then left where we were living in this, where there was this wonderful evangelical, very small, I couldn't fit in the pews. It was so tight. But an absolutely wonderful church. It was not overt in regard to its recognition of Mary, but it was certainly a church where she wasn't rejected. There was no sense of a need to play down Mary's role in salvation history, but certainly no building her up either. We then left, moved off to where I went to graduate school for my degree in clinical psychology, but where I also obtained a master's degree in theology. And in that area, we went to a very large church that was filled to standing room only, or in fact, the standing room would be filled at the Sunday morning service. The rector was a fantastic preacher. Information presented sounded like an evangelical church. It was 2 years into attending there that we became aware of the fact that some of the terminology wasn't somehow being interpreted the same way that we would have interpreted it. That it was a much more progressive environment, and began to realize that love others would mean that you don't hold to certain moral standards. And then in probably 2 years, 2.5 years into our attendance there, by complete chance, I came to the awareness that the rector's wife and daughter weren't his wife and daughter. They were his girlfriend and her daughter.
Whoa.
And that his girlfriend was not even divorced yet from her first husband. And that sort of floored me. And I had a very hard time attending there. I didn't continue to attend there.
Yet at the same time, he was filling the sanctuary with good-sounding sermons.
Good-sounding sermons, and probably the best music I've ever heard in any church anywhere.
Wow.
And that just left me bewildered. And I think that was that, in other circumstances, led to my wife and I, after graduate school, just not really attending church any longer. We just sort of became much more like the Bible and me kind of Christians. Yeah. That I was, from the time I was 12 on, I had heard most of the sermons that I was going to hear. And I don't mean that to sound arrogant at all, but there were such repeats in the, primarily because Protestant pastors preach from just those little parts of the Bible that they understand and see in their way. And when they delve into something new, they get away from it. I remember as young as 8, we were having a studies of Hebrews, which I was forced to go to. It was really an adult study, but they didn't have any kid thing for me to go to, and I had to sit there through this. And the pastor was teaching on Hebrews, got partway through it, and then dropped it, saying that it was just too hard to understand and that it really wasn't worth spending time on Hebrews. Of course, a church that doesn't accept the priesthood and doesn't accept
right.
the role Christ played in our becoming the sacrificial lamb, in a sense, in a real way, not just a symbolic way, I don't think can understand that. And so it just left us with a sense of, we know enough, we don't need to go to church. And we then, over time, our son came along. We had reached a point where we thought we weren't going to have any children, and had sort of just given it up. We weren't going to try the fertility route, even as me as a Protestant and her as a non-practicing Catholic. And then we were surprised by a child. And as he got older, we realized he needed to have more influence than just us in regard to the faith. And there was a wonderful youth group in a local church, and we let him start to go to that. And yet he would come home and we'd go over the material, and I was correcting some of the teachings in the material there. And without having been influenced by Catholic teaching at all, I was still correcting some of the terminology and the way a passage in Scripture would be read. And then the response was, but it doesn't mean that. It means something completely different. And I would correct that for him. But what I found myself doing was moving much more in that direction of what I would say Episcopal, what I understood the Episcopal Church to teach, and probably Catholic teaching as well, without even realizing it. Knowing that we have such limited time, I think it's important to get to what really sort of turned me. We had reached a point where we were attending that church on a regular basis, but I couldn't become a member. I wouldn't become a member because if we became members, my wife wouldn't have to be rebaptized. And I was at a point that I totally accepted the validity of her baptism, even though it had come via the Catholic Church. That caused my wife and I to wait. My son went ahead and was baptized and became a member of the church, and we just continued to attend. But that's where I ran into what I knew about the Catholic Church in the most powerful way. We had a sermon. I got to back up a little bit again. I had a friend by the name of Bob Frasco, a delightful man who's a good deal older than me, old enough to be my father, I think. And he one day asked me, why do evangelicals reject and demean Mary the way they do. And I gave him what I thought was the absolutely perfect Protestant answer. I said, Protestants learned the lessons of the Old Testament, and there's no way that Protestants are going to participate in idolatry. And he just about jumped out of his chair and he said, we don't worship Mary. We honor her just like Scripture tells us to. And I was dumbfounded. And I think that was the first time I became fully aware of the fact that while I had read all of the Bible, I hadn't read all of the Bible. Now, to be truthful, I actually thought he was wrong. And I didn't say this because I was just trying to be polite. But if I'd have given my gut instinct at that time, it would have been, well, of course, your bastardized version of the Bible that you Catholics created probably has that in there, but mine doesn't. And I have the authentic one. But I sort of committed myself to go back and prepare to bring him into the Protestant world and read the book of Luke. And when you first of all see the Hail Mary and realizing, boy, in my Protestant churches, those would be passages I wouldn't be allowed to recite. I could recite any other combinations of Scripture, but I certainly couldn't recite those. But to see that statement that, and you may have to help me on this because I'm not great at memorization, but that Mary in the Magnificat saying that she would be honored by,
right,
blessed by all generations.
All call her blessed, all,
yes,
generations, right?
Call her blessed. And all I could think of is what I had heard throughout my childhood that any girl would do. Mary was no one special. She was just a vessel used by God and not needed after Christ was born and raised. She was a status-seeking Jewish mother who was at Cana pushing her son forward to prove that she was the mother of the miracle worker. And one pastor even quoted that scripture of Christ saying to Mary, "What do I have to do with thee?" in such a harsh way and almost spit out the word woman that it would be Christ rejecting his own mother. And I think probably the most powerful message for me was one pastor, when I was about 13, 14, said the same thing. He went through that litany of Mary's just another woman. She was just a vessel. And he said any young woman would do. And he named two young women in our congregation. Unfortunately, one of them had a reputation that would have precluded being a virgin. And the other was one of my sisters who, bless her heart, was about as obstinate an individual. And I remember at that time thinking, how could Mary have been like either of these people? And at that point, not realizing how demeaning that is to this special role. I think it strikes me as really powerful to realize that if you ask any evangelical Protestant, any fundamentalist Protestant, does Christ have a plan for your life? They would say, absolutely. Did he have a plan for your life before you were even conceived? Absolutely. And they could quote the first book of Jeremiah, that before you were knit together in the womb, I had a plan for you. But there's one person in Scripture that God didn't have a plan for, and that was Mary, from a Protestant perspective.
Right.
Well, now jump forward to my son's participation in this church, and we were going home every Sunday and going through what the pastor had said and how he had interpreted the Scripture that he read and correcting it. I think I probably bored my son to tears on occasion. And we were still doing his youth group work and going through all of that material, and we would go over it with him because he was supposed to go over it, but I would then correct it. But Bob Frasco's question really forced me to start reading. And I read through what Scripture said about Mary, And then I went, I finally said, you know what? I was brought up to believe that we were practicing what the early church practiced. Now in Wheaton, I ran into a different concept, and that was reforming and always reforming, or reformed and forever reforming. That was sort of the newer evangelical view. But as a child and in my early Christian experience, the clear message was that we were practicing what the first century church practiced. So I now went to the sources I could find. I actually found a Protestant translation. I think Lightfoot,
right,
is a Protestant. I think he's Anglican, if I
remember. I think he's Anglican, right.
And so I went to that, and I found it was an old book that my grandmother had. Now it's interesting. I'm throwing also the idea that my grandmother, I thought, was a kook. She, as a kid, she one time told me that Mary was a perpetual virgin. I couldn't quite understand why she was saying it to me, because women shouldn't talk to teenage boys that way. But I thought she was just kooky, and I sort of had the impression that probably may have reflected why, you know, she and her husband divorced. She may have been trying to follow that. But she was very adamant about that, and I just chalked it up to my grandmother's a bit of a kook. My parents never held that view. They held the view that Mary had other children. But that fed into all of this as well. And then one Sunday, I keep getting confused because I have so much to say. I mentioned to you just earlier that when I finally converted to Catholicism, I wrote a 37-page letter to my family. That didn't even begin to touch on all of the different issues. So I have so much to say, and it's confusing to keep it all straight. But if we go back to the issue of my experience at the church with Mary, that I sat through a sermon where the pastor reiterated all of those earlier demeaning comments about Mary. And that was the day I realized I needed to make a decision. And I delved into the earliest church fathers. I thought, if I read the earliest writings of the earliest fathers, St. Ignatius of Antioch, St. Clement of Rome, St. Justin Martyr, that if they were like our church, if we were really being the early church, then that would confirm me staying in Protestantism. But when you pick up, in fact, I had read very little of St. Ignatius of Antioch, who wrote somewhere around 100 to 107 AD, as he was being transported from Antioch to Rome to be executed. And he wrote 7 letters to different churches along the way. Reading that, and to find that all of Catholic teaching in its core is there. And that changed my life overnight. I was through maybe the first 2 letters of St. Ignatius of Antioch when I knew I have to become Catholic. Mm-hmm. And to think that as early as at his time, he was talking about those who were rejecting that the wine and the bread became the true body and blood of Christ, or blood and body, I guess I should put it correctly. That changed everything for me. Literally overnight, I knew there was only one church. I then took the Catholic Catechism, and I went through and I excluded, put paper clips on all the sections that I wasn't familiar with. So,
I can imagine that book being real thick with all those paper clips.
Yeah. Well, not really, because coming up in the Holiness Movement, sure, there was an awful lot that paralleled the Catholic Church. And as I read through the Catholic Church's teaching on the Ten Commandments, on salvation, on the need for confessing our sins, it all made perfect sense. And I think the most powerful thing was that every bit of it was biblical. Yeah. And instead of what I came to realize we were doing as Protestants, where we would take one passage, and it didn't matter if this passage was apparently corrected or contradicted even by some other passage. If we liked it, that was our passage.
Yeah, yeah.
And what I found in the Catholic Church and in the Catechism was all the passages were dealt with so that you developed a full concept. You know, we can give a message to our child, don't do this and don't do that. And what it really is, it's not that you can't do this because I said don't do that. It's that somewhere between those parameters is where the truth lies. Yeah. And I think that's what the Catholic Church teaches, that we need to understand the full expression of Scripture. We can't proof text. We can't take this one passage that seems to say what we want it to say and run with it. We have to take the full passage. But that led me to realize, I think, what you've said in your own conversion story, that I discovered there were so many passages in Scripture that I didn't know. I didn't see. The meaning wasn't there for me. I couldn't even comprehend it. I think what's intriguing and what's really powerful for me is that the day I realized I needed to enter the Catholic Church, I woke up the next morning completely convinced of the sanctity of life. Prior to that, I'd been agnostic about abortion. I had seen it as a woman's issue, an unfortunate, sad circumstance, but certainly not my issue at all. And I woke up the next morning with just a sense. I remember sitting up on the edge of my bed and thinking, every baby matters. And that was a powerful experience for me. That mattered so much for me to have that experience, something I really didn't spend much time thinking about.
Had you gotten that because you read it in the Catechism and then agreed with it, or from within your own conscience was the Lord speaking to you, you think?
It was completely from within me.
Yeah.
In the sense that there was that I had not paid any attention to that.
Yeah. Okay.
And it just struck me as absolutely essential that I make a move in that direction. And you know, since that time, I have participated in vigils outside of the abortion clinics, and see that as something I will continue to do, because it's so important to me. What I think I came to realize was how solid the Catholic Church was in all of its teachings. I could accept every single thing of the material in the Catechism that I was familiar with. And at that point, I felt like it was necessary that I accept by faith that if a church could be so correct, so comprehensive in understanding of all of this material that I was familiar with, then I, on faith, would accept the truth of these other things. Things like purgatory that we tend to, as Protestants, completely ignore. And most hold to that idea that we never are made pure, that they sort of have bought into Luther's idea that we end up as manure heaps covered by the white snow of Christ in heaven. And I sort of picture Jesus sort of standing between the Father and us and hiding us from him, and dodging around to be sure the Father
never...
Well,
that's far from the way he's portrayed.
Yeah. And to realize that, no, the holiness movement that I was familiar with as a child, you had to grow in grace, is true.
Yeah.
I think I've come to the awareness that many of the Protestant churches teach a truth, but they don't teach the whole truth. And that's what I think is terribly unfortunate, is that it can lead people astray. And I've seen that so greatly in my own practice, where I've seen people who've been led completely astray because they believe that they're saved once, safe and secure for eternity, and they don't have to matter about how they live their life.
Yeah, your tradition, you had the either this holiness or the once saved, always saved. And the beauty of the Catholic is it's a both and.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we're called to continue to be holy by also recognizing that he did choose us, but he chose us to be holy. I mean, it's both this long journey of following Christ by grace. Wesley, thank you so much for sharing on the journey home. I know you have a lot more to to share with us. These programs are short, but I wanted to remind the audience that if they went to the website, they could read a little bit more of your story and contact you if they have more questions.
Mm-hmm. Well, it's an honor to be here. It really is quite a privilege to sit in this seat and to meet you. But most of all, to be part of Christ's church that he established directly and that has continued to exist for 2,000 years and teaching the same thing as it has for 2,000 years.
Thank you, Dr. Vincent. Appreciate that. And thank you for joining us on this edition of The Journey Home. I do pray that Dr. Vincent's journey is an encouragement to you. God bless you. See you next week.